about nice again. So it will be a revision sort of, and you get nice point, nice IVA point you cannot miss. So definitely it's more important. So this is ART. ART means, as I told you, anywhere you are handling the gamete or embryo outside the body is ART. Birth rate, if you see, it is per embryo transfer, it is 21.4% with IVF and 33% with ICSI. This is important. Sometimes they ask you this in SBA. This is per embryo transfer. Why they have given per embryo transfer is because some people will transfer two embryos. Some, even in our country, they transfer three embryos. So per embryo transfers, birth rate is 21%. So what are the steps? First of all, there will be pre-treatment adjuvant strategy. Why you give pre-treatment adjuvant? To cycle, to see, the IVF is not done for one lady at a time because their media is very costly. So they will do it in cycles. So IVF cycle means they will collect all the women, supposedly 10 women or 20 women they are going to do. So they want everybody to get period at the same time so that everybody will get trigger around at the same time and they can collect the egg and use the, once they open the media, they have to use it in within 1 to 3 days. So that's why they give pre-treatment adjuvant by oral contraceptive pill or progesterone to time her cycle so that all will fall in 1 day, 1, 2, 3 days, whatever. So accordingly, you will have the trigger and egg retrieval for all of them in within 2, 3 days so that your media will not be wasted. Am I clear about why we are giving adjuvant to the pre-treatment? It is not going to affect your success rate or anything. It is for your convenience and your cost saving when you are doing IVF cycles. So it is done in cycle with a group of patients. Am I clear about this pre-treatment adjuvant? It is by oral contraceptive pills or progesterone. Clear, all of you? Okay. Then comes the pituitary down regulation. Now you are giving outside hormones, so you don't want the women's natural hormone to interfere with your work. So you want to down-regulate her natural hormone. You want to suppress her natural FSH, LH, estrogen because you are giving from outside. You want to control it fully in IVF. You don't want her natural thing to interfere with you. So this down-regulation, two protocols are there, agonist and antagonist protocol. So we will go through that in detail later. So this is what down-regulation means. Suppress the natural hormone of women. Down-regulation of pituitary. Down regulation of ovary. Then comes the controlled ovarian hyperstimulation, where you will give the women injection to stimulate multiple follicle. Then you will give HCG for the trigger. That is the final maturation. Like in natural cycle, there is LH surge. In IVF, you will give trigger by HCG. Then come the egg retrieval and sperm retrieval, either by masturbation or by sperm, testicular biopsy or whatsoever. So sperm retrieval, egg retrieval. Then come the embryology part. They will develop the egg from day 1 to day 5 according to the quality of the egg, quality of the embryo. Then come this monitoring, the same till day 5. And then come the embryo transfer. And after you have transferred the embryo, you will do the luteal phase support. Because you have suppressed all her natural hormones, so she is not going to produce enough progesterone to support the pregnancy. So you are giving her luteal phase support. Am I clear about the steps of IVF? You understood what we are doing, and then we will go further for the details, how we do it.
Yeah.
Okay. So if you see, this is ovarian stimulation. She will take the injection. She can take herself. It is subcutaneous. And sometimes it is intramuscular. It will depend on the type of preparation. So pure FSH and all that is usually subcute. The conjugated max, the more purest form is coming in this prefilled syringe subcute, which she can take. The doses you will decide and tell her to take. She will take daily. So that way she will take the injection, or you will call her in the center and give her the injection daily. Then you will monitor by scan. You will see the ovary, how many follicles are developing, is it growing, not growing, what is happening with her. You will see by ultrasound monitoring. Then once the follicle growth are enough, you saw that the size has come around 18 mm, you are happy. That 18 mm is usually going to yield the egg. So how many 18 mm you count, you are happy about that. Like this all are looking almost same size. So 1, 2, 3, 4. Definitely 4 she has equal size almost. So you'll get at least 4 egg. Usually you will get around 10 to 12 egg in a normal responder, which is good. More than 14 is bad because after that the egg quality decrease and we don't want that. That means you are overstimulated her. 10 to 12 egg is good to get. This is how you will do the egg retrieval. You will put the vaginal probe and there is one needle attached here. In the probe only the needle is attached. This one here is the needle attached, and through that you will pass this. You are pricking the ovary by this small needle, and you will aspirate this fluid. So when you aspirate this fluid, egg is inside this only. So you get aspirate the egg also, and then you aspirate this in the tube, and then this tube you hand over to the embryologist, and then their job start. They will check the eggs. They will collect it. They will put it in the media and all that. Then their job start. Your job is only to retrieve the egg by aspirating the follicular fluid and give it in the tube to the embryologist. Temperature maintenance and everything, sterility maintenance. There shouldn't be any smell, anything in the IVF lab. IVF lab is a very sensitive lab. There shouldn't be any smell there because that could be detrimental for again embryo. So these all precaution you have to take. So this is how you take out the fluid. Then once you have aspirated this is how you, this is the needle through which you are aspirating the follicle, and this is the egg which is also getting aspirated. Once you get the egg look like this under the microscope. So the embryologist is already sitting inside. There's a window usually in IVF OT. It is not OT means like that. It is a clean place. It is a clean OT, and there will be a window through which you will give this test tube to the embryologist. The embryologist will put that fluid on the petri dish, and they will check for the eggs, and they will separate the egg and put in the nutrition media. So this is how the egg look. Okay, this is the zona pellucida. This is a beautiful egg, very good egg. So these are all good quality egg. This is the egg, and this is the polar body, and this is the zona pellucida. Am I clear about all the steps?
Yes.
Then once you have got it, you will put it in the dish. This is the dish where they will put the egg in the dish in the nutrition media, and then they will do. This is the ICSI. This is the ICSI where there. This is the stabilizing catheter through which this is all happening under microscope. Okay, so they have stabilized the egg by this catheter, and this is the injecting needle through which they are injecting the sperm inside the egg. So they have pierce the zona pellucida and inject the sperm, and immediately they come out without disturbing much the egg. They quickly enter and release the sperm and come out. So that this is ICSI. But in IVF, what they do is they leave the egg, and in this dish only they will leave the egg, and they will leave the most active sperm in the surrounding the egg. So what happened? IVF is more natural because sperm selection is happening naturally. You have put many sperm, and the egg will choose the most effective sperm, and the most effective sperm will go and stick to the egg, and the natural process of fertilization will happen. While in ICSI, you are doing it forcefully. You have selected the sperm, and you wanted that sperm to be injected in that egg. So it is more selective. So that's why whenever there is fertilization failure in IVF, when it is not fertilizing, you have put the egg, you have put many sperm, but fertilization not happening means sperm has some defect. So in that case, you will select the sperm and inject it in the egg. So this is how IVF and ICSI are different. Am I clear about how IVF is done and how ICSI is done? This is the photo of ICSI. In IVF, they only leave them together for natural fertilization. Clear?
Yes.
Then once this injection they have done, now this you have done the fertilization, then you have to monitor the egg. After 17 hours they will take under microscope that if fertilization has happened or not happened. If fertilization has happened, they you will be seeing two cells and two polar body. That means fertilization has happened. You are happy that fertilization has happened. So this is a good embryo, two cell embryo, and two polar body will be here. And then these good embryos will always have equal size and shape and clean looking. Really, this is a beautiful picture, and really the embryo look like this. So this two cell stage means the fertilization is successful. Then comes the four cell stage. Then comes the eight cell stage. So this eight, these all are cleavage stage embryo. Cleavage is happening. And this eight cell stage is day three embryo, which usually they used to transfer previously. Day three embryo, they used to transfer two embryo. In our country, we transfer three embryo. So this, if you're transferring day three, you are transferring two or three embryos. But for UK point of view, always remember two, not more than two. So you're transferring two embryos. But now, because the multiple pregnancy rate is more, they don't want that. So they have shifted to day five embryo, which is the blastocyst. Day five embryo is what they are transferring now, and they are transferring only single set, that is called single embryo transfer. So day five is what they are doing nowadays, and that's why the blastocyst transfer and all that, they are talking too much nowadays, because nowadays they are not preferring the day three embryo transfer until unless the quality is poor. Because if the quality is poor, the embryo is not going to survive till day five. Rather than putting the embryo for day five and wasting all the embryo when you already know the quality is poor, then you better transfer on day three. So making a blastocyst depends on the quality. If you get a very clean, good quality embryo, you will wait till day five for it to become blastocyst. But if the quality is poor, you will transfer on day three itself, so that at least the women get transfer and her chances, rather than getting nothing at the end of day five. Am I clear about this, the quality of embryo?
Please repeat, Dr. Shweta. This is the last step.
Yes.
Day five.
If the embryo is good quality, they will survive till day five and convert into a blastocyst. But if they will not be a good quality, if you put them beyond day three, they will arrest. Once they arrest in their growth, they are of no use. You cannot use it. So you have to predict from the beginning that is it a good quality embryo which you can take till day five, or if it is a bad quality or moderate quality embryo which you cannot take for day five, you will do day three transfer in such cases. Am I clear now?
Okay.
So day five is the best quality embryo with best success rate and very good. So blastocyst is day five embryo. You will do the embryo transfer through the ET catheter. So it is just like IUI cannula only, the thin plastic catheter. The embryo is loaded here by the embryologist and they will give you. And this is very sensitive thing. Believe me, nobody can be more stressed out than doing an embryo transfer for a woman. Because everything is so precise and so sensitive that they will load it with the particular amount of fluid, not 0.01 ml more, not 0.101 ml less. Amount of transmission media, number of embryo, how gently you have to go in, how gently you have to leave, where you have to leave the embryo and come out as gentle as possible so that the uterus will accept. So you're trying to make it as less traumatic for the uterus as possible, because if you do any trauma, the uterus is going to expel the embryo. Uterus will become angry. So you have to go very gently with a fixed amount of transferring media, and you will leave the embryo here. You will not leave very low. You will not leave very high. You will leave in the center of the cavity so that it will implant. So this is what the delicacy of embryo transfer is. So this is the last step, and after that you have to do the pregnancy test after 11 days of this. So now about the surgical intervention, these are the common SBAs, and this table is really very important. For hydrosalpinx, you will do salpingectomy always. For septum, you will do the septoplasty, and for submucosal fibroid, you will remove anything abnormal you are finding, you will remove. When you will not operate is what you have to remember. So you will not operate if intramural fibroid is less than 5 centimeters. If more than 5, you are operating. So 5 and less, you will not operate. You will not operate if there is subserous fibroid. You will not operate if endometrioma is less than equal to 4. Because more than 4, you are operating. So please remember when you will not operate. Because whenever you find any abnormality, you want to correct it before IVF. But you will not operate for a small intramural fibroid. You will not operate for subserous because it is not going to affect your process success. And you will not operate for small endometrioma because it doesn't change your success. So remember this chart table very well, because they will make a question saying that she has intramural fibroid of 3 cm. So you are tempted to choose the answer of myomectomy, but please don't do that, because myomectomy is indicated only for more than 5, and endometrioma surgery is indicated only for more than 4. But hydrosalpinx salpingectomy always is recommended. Here is the complex surgical cases, proximal tubal occlusion by hysteroscopy for complex surgery, means where the laparoscopy you are expecting is going to be complicated. No need of undergoing that complicated surgery, but simple hysteroscopic tubal occlusion you can do. Clear about this slide? Very important, and many SBA from this slide. Okay, good. So now, as I told you the steps, now we'll go on the detail of the step. So pituitary down regulation, as I told you, you want to suppress their natural thing. So there are two things, agonist and antagonist. So when you will choose agonist and when you will choose antagonist. You will choose agonist when you are suspecting that she's a normal woman with normal response you are expecting, normal responder. But you will choose antagonist if you are suspecting that she is a high responder or low responder. Because both the scenario, agonist is not going to yield many number of eggs. Only if agonist is for normal responder and antagonist is for all PCOS or old age where the response is less, you will choose the antagonist. How they work? Agonist, you will give in the previous cycle and it is going to give initial flare followed by suppression. Well, antagonist, you will give during the cycle once a particular size of egg is achieved, and you will be giving daily injection. While agonist, you will be giving 1 month injection. Like these are the agonist, leuproril, all the relin are agonist and all the relics are antagonist. Please remember this, because sometimes they give you the name. So the most common name is leuprorelin for the agonist, tetrorelics and zenirelics for the antagonist. So if you see, it is once every 28 days. So previous cycle on day 21, you will give the leuprorelin, which is going to work for next cycle up to 21 days. So no need of repeating, only one injection. While for antagonist, you will be giving daily injection, which is 250 microgram vial. So this is IMOD, which is you will be giving daily. So this is two protocol. Now, these are all the protocol of GNRH. Sometimes they ask you long protocol, short protocol. So if you see, this is the long protocol, GNRH analog long protocol. This is short protocol of GNRH analog, means agonist. And this is agonist ultra short protocol. These are all agonist protocols. And these three are antagonist protocol. So for agonist protocol, long protocol is the most commonly used one, where you give it on day 21 of previous cycle and then you start the gonadotropine on day 1 of her period. Once she get her bleeding, you'll start her on gonadotropine, which will be HMG, which has both FSH-LH or pure FSH. You will give that, and then once you reach the day of trigger, you will give her the trigger, which is HCG, and then you will do the retrieval and ET. In short protocol, what happened? You want to give it for a shorter period of time. So you will give from day 2. And then you will start the gonadotropin on day 3. Okay. So you are starting late. Here you were starting on day 21 of previous cycle and day 1 here. Here you are starting on day 2 and gonadotropin 1 day later, day 3. And you are giving up till trigger. So this is short flare protocol. Ultra short is where you give only for 2-3 days. Analog, you have started on day 2 and you have given only for 2-3 days and you have stopped it, not taken till trigger. That is ultra short, only for 2-3 days. And then 1 day later, you have started the same day 2, day 3, same day 2, day 3, you have done it. Am I clear about agonist protocols, three protocols?
My dear, can you kindly repeat it, please?
For agonist protocol, there is long, short, which is flare also, or ultra short. Long means previous cycle, day 21 you are starting, and day 1 of cycle, gonadotropin. Short means day 2 of the cycle, not previous cycle. This cycle, day 2 you are starting, and day 3 you are starting gonadotropin. Ultra short means only for 2-3 days, starting on day 2, but only for 2-3 days, not up till trigger. And day 3 you are starting the gonadotropin. Is it clear now, Dr. Gopal?
Yes, dear. Yeah. Thank you.
All this protocol have similar success rate. So please don't get confused that one is better than the other. Only this is chosen according to the patient scenario and individualized approach. But all this long, short, antagonist, any protocol you choose, the success rate is similar. So these are three about agonist protocol. Now antagonist, they sometimes ask you what is fixed and what is flexible protocol, means when you will give in cases of fixed and when you will give in cases of flexible. So fixed means you will be starting on day 6, irrespective of the size of follicle. Flexible means you will be starting when the follicle is more than 14 mm. So this is the difference, either day 6 or when the follicle size is more than 14. Now there is chances that the body will produce premature LH surge, which you want to suppress. That's why you are giving antagonist at this time. So you will start them on antagonist daily, you will give till the day of trigger. One is single bolus dose. If you have to give single bolus dose, you will give on day 8. So this is how the antagonist protocol work. And they usually ask you that what size of follicle you will start the antagonist, or what day you will start, or if you want to give single bolus, when you will give. So these are important. Am I clear about antagonist protocols?
Yes, ma'am.
So once you have taken her on the trigger day, means the follicle has become 18 mm size, you are happy. You have counted the follicle, how many eggs you are going to get, then you gave her HCG. HCG also is of two types. One is urinary HCG, which we usually give in our clomiphene-stimulated patient, which is like chorion and all that, Purgen and all that name. Another is recombinant one. Recombinant HCG is more purest form. And recombinant have a bit, they say that both urinary and recombinant has same success rate. You can choose whatever. But usually in IVF centers, they are choosing the recombinant one. So two type of HCG is there and both have similar trigger chances. So you can choose anything. Then after giving HCG, they will ask you when you will do the egg retrieval. This is a famous question. So after 36 hours, after 35 to 36 hours, 1.5 day. So today you have given the trigger. Tomorrow you will tell the women to relax and tell her to come day after tomorrow for the egg retrieval. She'll come for egg retrieval, which you will be doing under conscious sedation in the OR. And I already showed you how it is collected and given to the embryologist. Once the egg retrieval is done, then the ET will be there after 2 to 5 days according to embryo quality and growth. Once the ET is done, you are going to give her luteal phase support for total of 2 weeks. And then you will do the pregnancy test from 15 days from egg retrieval. This is also important. Sometimes they will ask you when you will do the pregnancy test. So it will be 15 days from the egg retrieval, not from the ET. Usually from ET, if you see, they will write 11 days from the ET. So forget about that, whatever written in the chart, because most of the question from TOG are formed from the chart and figures. So if they ask you when you will do the pregnancy test, always choose 15 days from egg retrieval. Clear? This is the how the IVF day-wise thing. What you do on which day. Usually on around 14 days, she will be ready for trigger. And then after 1.5 day, you have done retrieval. Then after 2 to 5 days, you have done ET and you have done the pregnancy test after 2 weeks. Now, this is what controlled ovarian stimulation means. Controlled ovarian stimulation means you want many eggs, but in a controlled manner. You are controlling it. This is the natural cycle where you get many eggs, but all are different sizes and only one dominant follicle. And all this will be atretic later. Only one dominant follicle, different size follicle. This is natural. And this is what you have done. Such a wonderful thing. Everything is looking clear. Everything is uniform in size. All are looking almost equal size. So you will get 5 egg here. Here you will get only 1 egg. Here in natural conception. And this is the IVF conception by controlled ovarian stimulation. You got so many eggs. So this is the drugs you use. HMG most commonly used and cheaper. And recombinant will be more costly. So recombinant FSH is more purified one. And this is what some IVF center will be using. And this is more costly. But they say that whatever you use, the success rate is similar. So it doesn't matter. For exam purposes, you don't have to worry about what to choose because all have similar success rate. So they will not give you two options of HMG and gonadotropin like that. Frequency of ultrasound, if you see, in agonist protocol, definitely you will do a baseline scan before stimulation to rule out if she already have some ovarian cyst or something. So baseline scan is important before stimulation. And you can check the enteral follicular count also at that time. And then second scan you will do 1 week after starting the injection. So you have given her FSH injection. You have told her to take whatever dose, either 300 or 450. So she will be taking that daily for 1 week. You will call her after 1 week for scan to see for this picture. Final scan you will be doing within 12 to 36 hours of plant trigger. Means according to the growth of follicle, you will get to know that when follicle will be fully mature, because usually follicle will grow 1 to 2 mm per day. So if you got supposedly 13 mm size follicle, then you will tell her to come after 5 days because you are expecting the 18 mm to happen on 5th day. So final scan you will be doing before the plant trigger, and then you will give the trigger. Only 3 times you are doing the scan. One baseline, one is 1 week after starting the injection, and one is before the expected trigger. Am I clear about this? Those they say that frequency is not clear, but still they ask you how frequently you will do the scan. So whatever they have given, you have to remember that. So 3 scans. Am I clear? Nobody is clear?
Yeah.
Okay, so this is what control. Now, as I told you, the AMH and AFC are detecting the response of the stimulation. They will not tell you about the success of IVF. This is also a famous question that if AMH is high or AFC is high, what it denotes? So it denotes that there will be higher response of stimulation. Doesn't denote anything about IVF success. So these all are predictor of ovarian reserve. So the more reserve she has, the more stimulated she will be. If you see, if she is high ovarian reserve, there will be more chances of eggs. So you will use the antagonist protocol so that you will minimize the OHSS risk. And if she is a low AMH, then she is a poor responder. So you are expecting under response. So you will again use antagonist protocol, but with maximum doses of FSH. Here, minimum doses because she's super response, high response. And here, low response. So, maximal FSH dose you will do. And you want to have some eggs at least in these women. In this, you want to decrease egg. In this, you want to at least have some eggs. So, you are using antagonist protocol in these two. While if you are expecting a normal response, you will do the agonist protocol. Am I clear about this? That these are predictor of ovarian response. Not the predictor of IVF success. So as we see, if AFC more than 16, it is high. So that's why high responder and low responder. Less than 4 is low responder. And this is normal responder. Clear? Sometimes they ask you the question of high responder, low responder, what you will use, what protocol you will use. So it is very simple. Only for normal responder, use agonist. Otherwise, always antagonist. Okay, so we have gone through all the steps. So this is the egg retrieval. As I told you, here is the needle attached. And they suck the fluid. And see, this is the gynecologist who is retrieving the egg. And this is the embryologist sitting here and watching the what do you say, the, now this is the growth of embryo, as I told you, 2-cell, 4-cell, 8-cell, and then it will become morula, early blastocyst and extended blastocyst. So this is good quality, this is bad quality, because this is too much of fragmentation. It is not looking like, all are not looking like similar shape and size. This is looking beautiful and clean, so this is good. And this is looking more fragmented and unequal in size, so this is bad. This is good blastocyst because this is inner cell mass, this is tofu ectodermal cell, and this is the cavity. So this is a good, very good quality blastocyst. And this is a poor quality because too much fragmentation, inner cell mass is also not clear and not looking good. So this is, sometimes they might, as I told you, nowadays they are giving more pictures. So sometimes they might give you pictures and ask you. So you should know how to differentiate good and bad quality embryos. So if you see, this is the cleavage day 3 because this is 8 cell embryo and this is cleavage stage embryo. And this is day 5 blastocyst. So this is all about this. Now this is the ET. If you are seeing, one person is showing the scan. This is the transabdominal scan. And this is the doctor who is doing the ET. He's seeing in the scan and precising himself as gentle and as clear to put the embryo in the right place. This is the embryologist who has loaded the embryo. This is the ET catheter, embryo transfer catheter. So they have loaded the embryo in this and they have given to the gynecologist, and he is doing the transfer under transabdominal ultrasound, while egg retrieval was done under TVS guidance, right? So this is how they inject the embryo in the middle of the cavity. This is how the embryo look like. Clear? Clear to all about embryo transfer? Very beautiful animated picture of abdominal scan guided. And this is how it look. You can see the catheter progressing in the scan. And then you leave the embryo, push it. You will push it and you will come out gently. There is an outer catheter. This is the outer catheter and there is an inner catheter. The inner, first you will put the outer catheter in the right place and then you will introduce your inner catheter, which is having the precious embryo. So you will not play with loaded embryo. First you will put gently your outer catheter, this one, and then put your inner catheter, which is having the embryo, and leave the embryo, push it here and gently come out. Clear? Clear, all of you?
Yes.
Okay, so this is how the embryo catheter look like. This is the outer catheter. This is the outer catheter. And this is the inner catheter. Okay, this is the thinner, finer. This is having the loaded embryo. And this is having all the markings. And this is the outer catheter, like IUI catheter. So different type of catheter comes. Embryo transfer, we already discussed what is day 2 to day 3. Which is cleavage stage, and day 5 to day 6, which is 64. Sometimes they ask you how many cells. So day 3 is 8 cell, and day 5 blastocyst, day 5 or 6 blastocyst is 64 cells. So don't mistake in that. It's an easy question. And once you understand the progress of embryo, which we saw here earlier, 2 cell, 4 cell, 8 cell, like that, the embryo progress. Now, this is whatever surplus embryo you will get, you will freeze it. Because Human Fertilization and Embryology Authority want the national target of multiple birth rate of 10%. That's why they don't prefer nowadays of day 3 transfer of 2 embryo, but day 5 transfer of 1 embryo is enough. Blastocyst, as I told you, single is enough. SET, which is called single embryo transfer set. So, which is what they prefer to decrease the multiple birth rate nowadays. So the surplus embryo you will freeze. This is the freezing. This is the nitrous oxide. This is very beautiful. As you see sometimes in ice cream centers, they show you how nitrous look. So this is the canister where they freeze the embryo. This is all the, this is the tube of that particular patient label, and they will keep their embryo in this tube, and this tube will be inside this. And this will be dipped in the, this is a big can. This is a very big can. And they will keep this here and label it here also, which patient name, number, whatever. So here they save it and they keep checking the temperature of nitrous, everything is good, and embryos are maintained in a very good condition. So this is how they freeze the embryo, and this is how they maintain the embryo in the canister. Am I clear about this? So whatever surplus good quality embryo you will get, you will freeze it. Why only good quality are freezed? Because if you freeze a bad quality one, when you take it out, when you thaw, it is not going to sustain, it will die. So when it is good quality, it will sustain the freezing and thawing, and then you can use it. So that is the beauty of embryo freezing, and that's how you can use all the surplus embryo in the next cycle. Clear?
This is my Telegram channel. You can join the Telegram chat where you will have the daily module-wise discussion of the question answers. You can put your doubt. There is a schedule to follow. So that all will help in your preparation. This is the Facebook group, all with MMRCOG. So it will help you in your preparation. And I'll be happy to assist you all. Thank you very much for listening to the recording.